I can remember, I mean, the whole subject of sort of the role that, that white communists played in integration struggles that brought back some memories for me of arguing with friends at, I went to a school that was predominantly white because the districts, the school districts were gerrymandered so that even though I lived in a multiracial neighborhood, everybody went to their own schools. And I can remember getting into arguments with white friends who, I couldn't kind of get racism. I just didn't understand even what was going on. It was bewildering to me. And I felt like this, I would lose friends. People would stop talking to me. Other kids would stop talking to me because I would be defending black kids and I would be arguing with people about racism. The internal struggle I've been going through right here is, you know, and you said some pretty heavy things earlier, and I came from a very abusive family, and I feel very, I feel this this pull, this tug, because I'm, on the one hand, I retain my family's politics and retain my family's sort of commitment to social change, and I've been very involved in the feminist movement and in leftist movement stuff. On the other hand, my parents were shits. My parents were terrible to me, and I think that, a lot of that had to do with the fact that they were under a lot of pressure because of anti-communism. I don't know how much of it had to do with that and how much of it had to do with that they had terrible childhoods. They had terrible childhoods because they grew up very poor, and part of why they became communists was because of those childhoods, but it also made them bitter, angry people who abused their children. And I get scared, I mean, especially when some of what you were saying about how we have to look at some of the failings of the old left. I don't want to like contribute to a sort of old left bashing, because I feel like there's a lot that sort of the feminist movement and the movements that are alive today could learn from the old left that we failed to learn from the old left because the ties were severed in the 50s. I can remember getting into arguments with my mother when I started getting involved in feminist politics and leftist politics in the late 60s. I had no interest in what she had to say about things, and I totally discounted. She had years of political organizing experience. Half the arguments that I was being involved with, half of the organizational struggles that I was participating in, I could have sat down with her. She could have told me a lot of really useful information. I had no interest in it. And, and part of that is my personal issues with my mother, and part of that is that the outside world wasn't validating the fact that there was this whole generation before me of people who had been involved in politics. Even though I feel like the old left took some wrong turns in terms of the sort of knee-jerk support of the Soviet Union, I think that there was a lot more going on that I don't feel like, I feel like I still don't have most of the story. I feel like I got information about my parents' politics so almost by osmosis. Most of my mother's political attitudes I learned from her getting into arguments with the TV set, with her getting angry at the TV news. That's where I picked up the information about my parents' politics, more so than them sitting down and having or over at the dinner table, people getting into arguments. But I don't feel like I ever got sort of a coherent picture, partly because of the isolation, partly because by the time I was old enough to have participated in any kind of even, by the time I, it was only when I was very, very young that my parents were actively involved in politics. And then I don't know how, even if I had been older, I don't know how much I would have known about, they went away to meetings. I don't remember ever going along to meetings. I don't know if I did or not. But by the time I was old enough to really grasp what was going on, there were no other adults involved in the discussions. It was my parents stopped speaking to each other when I was probably 7 or so. So I never even heard them discussing political issues with each other. So I don't even know where I have a very coherent kind of leftist analysis that which I have also, you know, supplemented with doing study groups and trying to, you know, but I couldn't even exactly say where it comes from. I couldn't exactly, it's not like, you know, my parents sent me off to catechism school or, you know, everyone I knew in my growing up, especially in elementary school, almost everyone I knew was religious in one way or another. They were getting religious instruction. I knew I wasn't religious. I would get into arguments with people about how clearly there was no God. I couldn't understand how they could think there was a God. But I don't know even where, I didn't have like the equivalent religious instruction in being a Marxist, but somewhere I picked it up. Somewhere that became my worldview. And I value that. I'm really glad that I got that from my parents, even though when it comes down to it, it's about the only thing that I can say that they gave me. And I don't know how much, you know, how much their abusiveness had to do with. They were, you know, my father lost one job because of being a communist. He had another job for my entire life. He died when I was 19, but from the time I was born, right before I was born, till he died, he had the same job. He was working for a labor union as a clerical worker, and it was a relatively conservative union, and they must have, I would find it very hard to believe that the FBI never informed the people in the union that he was a Communist Party member. So I don't know who went to bat for him. I don't know how he managed to keep that job. I do know that his boss sexually abused me, and I do feel like that part of why he got away with that and part of why that happened was because of my father's fear of losing his job. And I don't, you know, I mean, the level of fear that my parents felt. They had both grown up poor. They were scared shitless of not having any money, of not being able to work. And that had a major impact on my life. And that was because of anti-communism.
You know, when you talk about growing up in an abusive family, and I think in some ways my family had many characteristics of abusive families. Because you talk about in alcoholic or abusive families, you talk about family secrets, and we all had family secrets. And some of us spent more time in supportive environments, and, you know, some of us spent less time in supportive environments, and we were all very happy whenever we found a supportive environment where we didn't have to have those secrets. And for me it was camp, and each one of us found different places. So how do you separate? I mean, how do you know what is your own family's tendency to be to have secrets within the family? I mean, when parents don't talk to each other, parents don't talk to kids, parents don't validate kids, or parents outright abuse kids, how much of that forms you, and how much of going out in the world and not being able to say who you are forms you? And I'm sure it's both or all of the above. I'm sure it's all of the above. You know, when you asked about, I referred before to having issues other than fear. I think one of my issues is what I would call marginality. I mean, it's, mm-hmm. you know, just always having 18 years of the experience of not being part of this school environment around me, and then playing another role that wasn't even who I really was, and having this other role of who I really was. And how do you know what you really are? Is what you really are what you do, like 85% of the year or 90% of the year? So I think later, for me personally, in college, when all the New Left stuff started going on, I didn't know what it meant to just do what everybody else did. I had no concept of, or emotionally, there was no reality to me of just doing what everybody else did. My reality was doing something different from what everybody else did. So when stuff started happening, it made a lot of sense to me politically. I'd always say, well, yes, but, you know, yes, but, yes, but. And eventually some of that has worked out for me. But you know, how long... What is the lasting impact of living for many, many years, living a lie, living a public persona that's different from your private persona, and where do they, who knows where you are really in all of that? So, just some thoughts.
You read every spy book that comes out. That's what I do. Jean-Luc Carré.
There's a real gap here. I mean, maybe I sounded too negative before about this conference. I'm very happy to be here, and I think people look wonderful. I really do. For the first time in years, I think maybe we're all a little older. We're all a little more secure. And I think people really look great, and I'm happy to see them. And I think the people at this conference are really the survivors. I mean, there's a lot of people we all know that we left along the wayside and got lost somewhere. But, there's something that we forgot. You know, we're romanticizing this, and we're... There was a real break back in the 60s. I mean, we are red diaper babies, but at that point, we did reject our parents. We did create a new left. We created movements. I remember the mass movement out of the CP, out of the LYL. I mean, the Soviet Union was the betrayer of the revolution. That's what we all believe. I don't mean all of us here, but I mean the people that I grew up with. The people that I grew up with founded PL. They were on their way to China every 2 months, you know, looking for the new seat of wisdom. My friend Jake was the foreign minister of PL. The only person I know who's ever been received in Albania by the dick. So, I mean, but we consciously rejected this thing that we're now celebrating, that we're now remembering. And that was a very, very important period of our lives. And maybe the next generation, I mean, you'll be interviewing, you know, the kids that are new, whatever, pink diaper.
Green diaper babies.
Green, whatever they are. But I mean, but it's important to remember that. We all came to that crisis back in the early 60s, after our parents, most of whom left the party. They all left about the same time with the Hungarian Revolution. I mean, the party emptied out like the party last night after 12:30. Just, you know, everybody went home. And then the kids, my generation, we all went into something new. I mean, we're the ones who started SDS. We're the ones who founded PL and all these little, sectarian groups. That was us. I mean, I remember the first labor committee meetings. I mean, I remember Lynn Marcus when he was a jerk down in 14th Street, but you couldn't say he was a jerk. He was supposed to be very brilliant, you know? And we all have this history in us, and to just try to remember that one part, for as rich as, I mean, it's a valuable, rich experience, and I wouldn't have missed that. The FBI part I could have missed, but the 60s are very important, too. That's what I'm saying. And the New Left is very important. I think that's the most important thing we did, was to create the New Left. And I think the New Left was created by the Old Left in the act of rejecting the Old Left.
The thing that strikes me is that we had to consciously decide what we were going to do with politics, yes. Whereas for most Americans that was not true. And I think about, I have a brother who is a veteran of the psychedelic wars and was in Berkeley. And he sort of went from that. He was in the new age in the late 60s. I mean, he really was way advanced. And so I think we've been able to live perhaps a difficult life, but certainly a very full life, because we at least can see the full depth of what the possibilities are. And there was something that was said earlier about our parents and a view of the future, and, you know, this sort of the monolithic Soviet state as one part of the view, but my view of what my parents wanted was really a better life for their kids. My parents were very poor people, and I think it was really important for their kids to be able to do better. And that was really the gut sense of why people were communists. They were coming out of really very, very poor, difficult situations and wanting something better for their kids and for everyone. And because there was a lack of understanding, I mean, everything wasn't just economics. There are a few other dimensions. No one knew about them. I mean, they may have been known, but they weren't articulated. And I think they were doing as good as they could do with what they knew. I mean, when I go through periods and I get pissed off at my mother and we have arguments, which we don't do too much now, but we have had periods, you know, she just will say, you know, I've done what I could do. And she really, you know, I think they did what they thought was best.
What they gave us, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
What they gave us, you know, what I have out of this, the most, I live by history and I live in history. I'm part of the world I live in. And most of the people I know that I run across are not. I mean, that's what it's given me. I'm part of the world. You know, and it's important to me what happens in the world. And,
my grandmother had a mink coat. And, you know, she was a party member and left and so on. She was a lifelong communist with a small c, purist. You know, of course, she'd have it. Explanation for everything, but you know, when she died, my cousin gave the eulogy, and he talked about the contradictions, and he talked about her mink coat, and he said, it was sort of like bread and roses. I mean, everybody, you know, what the revolution was about, or what all this, because I don't know if she really always believed there'd be a revolution, but maybe she did. That the revolution was really about, you know, having antiques and diamond rings and mink coats for everybody.
I remember this phrase, you know, come the revolution, we'll all eat strawberries. But I don't like strawberries. Come the revolution, you'll eat strawberries.
You better like strawberries.
And that is sort of both sides of it.
My father died, but my mother was very supportive of my politics. I went to one of the first student trip to Cuba in 63, and she was nervous, you know, but she was happy about it. I mean, she, you know, we were breaking the travel ban, and we were fully expected to be arrested when we got back. Kennedy said he was gonna, what did he say, he was gonna stop our traveling for a while, he said, in a press conference. But she was there at the airport when we got back, and we had a whole cheering committee, and she was supportive of my politics. Although she left the party herself right after that. I mean, she just dropped out after she went into all that. She got into all that trouble. But she always supported my whatever political activity I did. Although we were not friendly. I mean, she was not abusive in the sense that you said, but we were not friendly. I left the house when I was 20 years old. I mean, we just did not get on. And I've always kept 100 miles or two or three rivers between us, you know. She's a very difficult person, but I will say she, you know, and she died with well before the Alzheimer's struck. She always had a political consciousness, and we learned about politics at the dinner table. I did. I mean, that's, you know, my parents talked about, and as they talked back to the television, they talked back to the radio, and most leftist kids I know, their parents, you know, Walter Cronkite would come over, whoever was in those days, Chet Hurley, you know, and say, you liar, you know, that's not so, you bastard. Always talking back to the media.
I remember it was before I went to college, so it was probably in 1956 or 57, I was involved in integrating skating rinks on the western suburbs of Chicago. And I remember getting a lot of support for it. You know, it was so almost a very technical thing, because you'd go in, a couple of white kids would go in, and then either an interracial group or just some blacks would go in, and then you'd have a court case. And we did this all over the western part of Chicago. And It took about six or seven years before the court cases came, actually, you know, took place. And we, of course, we won, and we integrated all these skating rinks in the middle 60s, which is pretty bizarre. But, you know, that it seems so incredible, the struggles that we had back then, you know, and the things that we now take for granted. That isn't to say there aren't the type of economic oppression that we now have is it's just very different.